An accidental explosion in Afghanistan has caused the death of four American soldiers. Good evening and welcome to NewsCenter at 5:30. I'm Jason Luzak.
And I'm Jill Crean. An unseen video of Osama bin Laden has been found. A top aside shown bin Laden discussing the September 11th attacks. CNN's Elaine Quijano tells us more about the footage.
In this latest videotape released by the Arabic language television network Al Jazeera, Osama bin Laden appears with a top deputy who takes credit for the September 11th attacks. It's not clear when the video was made, but Al Jazeera officials say it was given to them as part of a documentary from a production company that supports bin Laden's Al-Qaeda terrorist organization. Also included in that documentary, a separate videotaped will and testament prepared by one of the hijackers with what appears to be an electronically inserted graphic of the World Trade Center towers in flames on September 11th. On the tape, the hijacker talks about his plans for the attacks in the heartland of the United States. In Afghanistan, the U.S.'s war on terror continues with a deadly start to the week for the U.S. Army. Just north of Kandahar, four soldiers died, one was wounded as they took part in an operation to clear out explosive ordnance.
It was a disposal unit that was actively working to destroy some weapons that had been found. And for whatever reason, one of them went off.
The soldier was evacuated back to the U.S. base hospital in Kandahar. Pentagon officials say they are continuing to receive reports about the accident as they move forward with the investigation. At the Pentagon, I'm Elaine Quijano.
The West Bank town of Jenin has been called the center of terror, according to Israeli Prime Minister Ariel Sharon. Sharon says that his country has nothing to hide in the refugee camp. Palestinians found 14 bodies in the camp, but were only able to take out seven, fearing that the buildings would collapse on the rest. Palestinians have called the forces in Jenin camp, a massacre.
Also dealing with the Middle East, supporters of Israel gathered today in Washington, D.C. People boarded buses from Philadelphia and other major cities where they joined thousands of others in a pro-Israeli march in Washington, D.C. Demonstrators rallied to show their support for Israel's battle against terrorism. Former New York City Mayor Rudy Giuliani spoke to the crowd along with congressmen and religious leaders.
There was a major scare at the banks in Washington, D.C. today. Police received a call from the Netherlands revealing a supposed plot to bomb a large bank in the nation's capital. The threat was called in by a 13-year-old boy as a joke. The FBI said that they did not take the threat seriously, but some D.C. banks did close for a short period of time.
Well, aside from the Celtics, Red Sox, and baked beans, Boston is known for having one of the nation's largest marathons. Security was tight at today's 106th annual Boston Marathon. There were more than 600 off-duty law enforcement officers at the race to monitor the more than 1 million spectators. Rogers Rop of Kenya won the 26.2-mile race. And Rebecca Clark is here with weather. It was nice here. What about in Boston? What was the weather like for all those runners out there?
It was actually pretty nice to be running. Was it 26.2 miles?
That's a lot of miles.
What a run. Yeah, actually, today the weather in Boston, they had some broken clouds. And right now, drizzly conditions, 48 degrees out there. But in Muncie today, we reached a high of 82. And I'll have a complete look at the forecast in just a bit.
Thanks a lot, Rebecca.
Thanks. Every year, millions of Americans wait until the last minute to get those tax returns in. Each taxpayer spends about 28 hours getting their taxes ready. Post offices across the country are even staying up late to accommodate the procrastinators. The filing deadline is also the same time for the national annual taxpayers rally in D.C. Americans at the rally will be calling for changes in the tax code.
Well, and people here in Muncie are currently filling out their tax returns.
NewsCenter's Elliot McInnes visited the post office and joins us live at the news desk. Elliot?
Well, that's right, Jason and Jill. I did visit the post office. I saw a steady stream of people filing their taxes. They still have until midnight tonight. The main Muncie office on 501 West Memorial will be the only place in the 473 zip code area that will be open extended hours. Postmaster General Randy Clark says his office decided to remain open because it is good for the public. Clark says he's seen less people this year because he believes it is easier for people to file their tax returns online. And Jason and Jill, I hope that you have your taxes taken care of.
I am not one of those procrastinators.
Neither am I.
I have filed, Elliot, so don't worry. Thanks a lot,
Elliot. If you're still running around collecting receipts and doing math for today's tax deadline, you might not be in a joking mood.
But although the deadline is just hours away, CNN's Skip Lozier finds some humor in the situation.
Paying taxes. But you know, it's not the end of the world. Although it is serious business to some.
Look, my sister being a tax administrator, generally taxes are not funny in my family.
But for the Capitol steps, it's political satire.
When I am escalated from sight, watch your taxes multiply. If you ever missed a fighting,
I asked my accountant just yesterday, I said, am I getting a refund? And he laughed.
In Seattle, the force is with some taxpayers.
When will Bill Stormtroopers undertake to file their taxes? When? We don't file our taxes, we collect them.
The human endeavor is a bit more stoic.
Please do not steal. The IRS hates competition.
Saying, like taxing poetry?
As April 15th draweth nigh, my spirits start to droop. A poor, downtrodden slave am I, in short, an income poop. And what can you do?
So I give the address of the IRS to my friends at the IRA.
In Washington, I'm Skip Lozier. Skip Lozier, CNN, Washington.
Well, good thing Skip can find some humor in that situation. Well, former Indiana Congressman Phil Sharp will be donating his papers from his term in the U.S. House to Bracken Library today. He'll donate 140 boxes of papers he kept during his 20 years in Congress, which will be available for research. Sharp was an assistant and an associate professor of political science at Ball State from 1969 through 1974. He served in the U.S. House from 1975 to 1995. Sharp is currently a teaching fellow at Harvard University's John F. Kennedy School of Government. He'll be at Emmons Auditorium tonight at 8 p.m. to officially present those papers to Ball State.
A newly released report from the Center for Disease Control estimates that more than 6 million children in the U.S. will die prematurely from tobacco use. The report is leading anti-smoking advocates like the American Cancer Society to state that most states are not doing nearly enough to reduce tobacco use in teens.
This new CDC report shows us that tobacco continues to take an enormous toll in Indiana. 167,000 kids alive today will die prematurely from tobacco use. And smoking caused health care costs are now over $1.5 billion a year. This CDC report is a wake-up call for Indiana's leaders that they must raise the cigarette tax to prevent kids from starting and to reduce the health care costs from tobacco.
The CDC says that Indiana should spend more money on preventing people from smoking.
An increase in federal funding was announced today for the study of I-69. Indiana Senators Bayh and Lugar announced that the Indiana Department of Transportation will receive $2.5 million in extra funding to study the possibilities of expanding I-69 between Evansville and Indianapolis. And after the break, we'll tell you about rising or failing employment rates in Indiana.
Plus, we'll fill you in on the financial problems facing Eli Lilly and company. This and more coming up after the break. Indiana workers have suffered more job losses than any other workers in the country. Indiana employees have lost 95,000 jobs in the past 2 years. International competition and corporate buyouts have been the blame for the unemployment troubles. Economists have said that recovery is unlikely. And while the jobless rates are growing, the state auditor and treasurer have transferred $9 million dollars to the state's primary checking account in hopes that Governor Frank O'Bannon will use the money to offset the planned funding cuts for schools. Instead, O'Bannon plans to use the money to help plug a state budget deficit projected to be nearly $1 billion by next summer.
Conseco bondholders now have more time to swap debt notes for ones with later maturity dates. The swap will help Conseco keep up with debt payments. Bondholders now have more time to swap the more than $2.5 billion in debt notes. So far, bondholders have exchanged $1.8 billion in debt notes. In trading today at the New York Stock Exchange, Conseco shares rose 17 cents to $4.87. And in other financial news, Indianapolis-based Eli Lilly and Company's earnings have declined for the third straight quarter. The pharmaceutical company has posted three straight quarters of losses despite showing gains in sales of its top six selling drugs. Lilly has shown a net income of $629 million this year as opposed to its net income a year ago of $807 million.
Empty offices and manufacturing plants have become the sign of economic slowdown in Bloomington. About 22% of the city's office space and 34% of its industrial space is now vacant. Prior to 1997, the vacancy was under 5% for office space and 10% for industrial space. While new construction is in the area, has created some of the emptiness, most of it has come from the firms who have downsized, closed, or moved. And economic slowdown may be to blame for increased amount of felonies in Evansville. Last year, the city says an increase in the amounts of battery, robbery, theft, arson, and felony drug violations. Murder and rape reports are the only categories that did not see an increase. The city had averaged about one murder every 6 weeks last year, and the confirmed reports of rape fell by 20% last year. And Rebecca, the weather outside today was absolutely beautiful.
Great. I loved it.
Did you like that?
Thanks for giving me some good weather.
Warm temperatures, no problem. Glad I could do that for you. But what's on the way? I'll have the latest on the forecast when NewsCenter at 5:30 continues. What a gorgeous day in East Central Indiana. Today, Muncie topped out 82 degrees. Well above the normal high of 60. The low this morning was set at 62, the normal at 41. If you'd like to see the sunset, you should be able to do that this evening. Not too many clouds in the sky. 720, pardon me, for the sunset, and will rise tomorrow at 602. Here's the highs across the state. Muncie checked in with 82, Indianapolis 83, the warmest part of the state, South Bend, Indiana with 87 degrees. Currently outside, it's partly cloudy, temperature still at 82, the high, winds coming out of the southwest at 11 miles an hour, and our humidity is at 51%. Here's a look at the national radar. You can see crystal clear across most of the Midwest. A cold front back to the West Coast, bringing some rain for them. Nothing here, though. Muncie will be clear for the rest of the evening. And as we look at the satellite imagery, here's a boundary right across the west. And part of this, we should see this by late tomorrow night and possibly into Wednesday. A thundershower is possible. Here's a regional look at our radar. Just a few scattered clouds. There are a few clouds over Muncie. The resolution of the radar didn't pick them up. But if you look outside, there are just a few broken clouds. Here's tonight's national map. A boundary system, an occluded front, and low pressure coming our direction. We should see the effects of this by late tomorrow evening, possibly afternoon. We might see a thundershower or two pop up. Before tonight, clear skies, a late shower possible, very slim possibility, low down to 60. Winds continued out of the south at 12 miles an hour. And tomorrow, as we look nationally, the system kind of breaks apart, but a new one starts to form, picking back up with the rain possibly on the way and maybe a thundershower. For tomorrow morning when you wake up, should be cloudy skies, 67 degrees, and winds hailing out of the south, 10 miles an hour. As we look through all day tomorrow, partly sunny skies, a late afternoon thundershower is possible, the high back up to 82 degrees, and winds out of the south, once again, 15 miles an hour. And for your extended forecast, looks like chance of rain on Wednesday, cloudy skies for Thursday. And on Friday, another chance of some rain and the temperatures start to fall a bit. But not too bad. We're not getting down into the 40s.
It looks like that nice weather is going to stick around for a while.
It should. I think spring has finally arrived.
I don't like seeing all that rain and everything. Well, Jake Johnson is here. Weather really played a big role in the Masters this weekend.
Yes, it was sunny all weekend long in Augusta, and I will tell you who won the green jacket right after this break.
Oh,
While the season is finally winding down for most of the Ball State students, the football team is just getting started. On Saturday, the Cards hosted the annual Cardinal and White game out at Ball State Stadium. The game is a chance for the coaches to contrast who's going to play and who's not next season. And it was Scott Blair's performance at tailback that made the impression, filling in for senior tailback Marcus Merriweather, who was out due to injury. Blair rushed for over 171 yards and one touchdown on 33 carries to help the White team defeat Talmadge Hill and company and the Cardinals. 12-7, Hill finished the game with 4 of 15 passing for 38 yards and 19 yards rushing. The Ball State men's volleyball team managed to snatch their share of glory this weekend as they defeated Mercyhurst and IPFW to claim co-champs in the Midwestern Intercollegiate Volleyball Association. The number 9 Cards hosted Mercyhurst on Friday and defeated the Lakers 30-23, 30-18, 30-16 by slamming back 16 blocks on the night. In order to get the number 1 seed in the tourney, they would have to defeat IPFW in the final game of the season. The Cards pulled out the victory with the sweep 30-18, 30-21, 30-25. This is the 21st title in school history. And this weekend also proved to be a good one for the Ball State baseball team as they took their game to Miami. The Cards split Sunday's doubleheader, stealing 3 of the 4 games this weekend from the Redhawks. Cards pitcher Brian Bullington kept Miami in check by striking out 2 batters and only allowing 1 run in a rain-shortened 7-inning game. Bullington is the reigning MAC Pitcher of the Year and intends to keep his streak alive.
Well, it's obviously a great honor. I mean, as a junior doing it in only 3 years, hopefully that'll be something I'll be able to put in my back pocket and move on. But we're just trying to win some games right now and really enjoying how we're playing right now.
You know, he's a great pitcher, and it's to be a tremendous honor to win to have the MAC record in strikeouts simply because there's been a lot of great pitchers throughout the years in the Mid-American Conference. Several played and had successful careers in the major leagues.
Also racking up power points for the Cards were Paul Henry, Brad Snyder, and Jason Buchholz, who combined for 15 hits and 8 for extra bases. Ball State is back in action again on Tuesday against Notre Dame. And in a sport dominated by one man, this weekend, Tiger Woods claimed his 3rd green jacket of his career as he won the Masters in Augusta, Georgia. Woods went 72 entire holes with only 7 bogeys. He birdied 2 and 3 to get to 13 under, and he bogeyed the 6th, but birdied the 7th to continue to save and stretch his lead over the field. It was the back 9 where Tiger ran away, though, as the rest of the field took desperation shots to catch Woods. He played it safe and finished at 12 under for the win. Retief Goosen, who could not catch the master and finished 2nd. That win gives Tiger his 7th major championship win.
Well, you know, Jake, that win just amazes me because of the weather they had. Tiger had to shoot like 26 holes in one day. That, you know, people don't really think that all that pressure, and it really does take a lot to play 26 holes of golf.
That is a lot of golf in one day, but it's Tiger Woods.
He's Tiger. He's the best. He's Michael Jordan. What can I say? Well, thanks a lot, Jake. Coming up after the break, Rebecca Clark will have one last look at your wake-up weather.
And a new kind of Coke. We'll tell you more about it in just a few minutes. And Rebecca Clark joins us now with a look at our weather. Rebecca, it's a beautiful day, and you told us earlier the weather is going to continue, but what's it going to look like tonight?
You can't fool me. I saw some little lightning bolts in those graphics. What's that all about?
You saw those? Oh, you weren't supposed to see
those. I caught them.
Yeah, there's actually a chance for a thunder shower. We'll talk about that in a minute. For tonight, clear skies, possible late shower, not a thunder shower, just a nice little shower, low down to 60. When you wake up tomorrow morning, cloudy skies, 67 degrees, winds out of the south at 10 miles an hour. And all day tomorrow, partly sunny with a possible late afternoon thundershower. Nice for the storm chasers. Bad for just the regular people walking to class, I guess. High up to 82. And for your extended forecast, chance of thundershower again on Wednesday and Friday. Thursday, cloudy skies prevail and highs in the mid-70s for the rest of the week.
Okay, thank you, Rebecca.
You're welcome.
And new tonight at 9:30, former Representative Phil Sharp will be donating his congressional papers to Ball State University's library. NewsCenter talked with Representative Sharp about his donation, and we'll have an update on the Middle East. Tune in to see these stories and more tonight on NewsCenter at 9:30.
Well, as we mentioned a couple of weeks ago, a new twist will be added to Coca-Cola soft drinks. The new Vanilla Coke will be in stores on May 15th. This is a longtime favorite of soda drinkers and will taste like Coke Classic, but with an added hint of vanilla. Coke Classic now sells more than 2 billion cases a year, billion in the United States.
Finally tonight, we'd like to congratulate a few members here of the NewsCenter family. Scott Hums and Ricky Simler won first place for feature reporting from the Society of Professional Journalists. And Scott Hums also won two other photography categories. Also, NewsCenter won first place for best daily newscast. NewsCenter competed against other newscasts, including Northwest University, the University of Southern Illinois, and Kent State. Congratulations to everybody here on all of your hard work. And it's our last week here at NewsCenter, and we won't be back on until August.
But before we leave, we'd like to thank one great director, Jerome Harrison, for his work here at NewsCenter. It's his last show here with us, and Jerome, good luck after graduation.
That's right, and it's also your last night here, Jason. Jason will be going to London for a semester.
We'll kind of sad. It's here. Thanks for joining us at NewsCenter at 5:30. I'm Jason Luzak.
And I'm Jill Crean. NewsCenter 43 is an official CNN student bureau. Be sure to tune in tonight for NewsCenter at 9:30.